All right. So in these last couple days of school here, I wanted to do something a little bit lighter and a little bit different and introduce a really fun, kind of interesting topic, in my opinion, on probability. So for this, what's going to happen is I'm going to give you just really, really short highlights on a few probability topics, and then you'll have some sort of little activity that you have to do rather than a worksheet to get your credit for these last few lessons. So this lesson is talking about the difference between what's called theoretical and experimental probability. And first of all, the definition of probability itself, you guys are probably already pretty familiar with that, but it's just how likely something is to happen, the likelihood of something occurring. And probability is really, really cool in my opinion, because you see it everywhere in the real world. You see it in weather forecasts, what's the probability it's going to rain? You see it in insurance, auto insurance, how much you're being charged and stuff like that is based on the probability you're going to get in an accident. It's all over sports, what's the probability this team will win? What's the probability this batter is going to hit the ball to left field? It's just prevalent everywhere. So having a basic knowledge of probability is a very useful thing. It's also on the ACT a lot too. There are two kinds of probability for today's little mini lesson here, and we're focusing on the difference between a theoretical probability and an experimental probability. Theoretical probability is the actual mathematical probability that can be calculated, and the way you find a probability is by counting your sample space, and then there are also more complicated formulas you could use. What do I mean by sample space? Let's say I had a jar that had 10 marbles in it. And three of them were red. And I asked, what is the probability I get a red marble if I pick one? Well, there are three reds out of 10 marbles, so the probability is 3 out of 10. That's a theoretical probability. It's what should happen, based on the math behind it. And you can know that by just looking at how many options there are. Then there's something called an experimental probability. Experimental probability is more useful when either the formulas are really complicated, so we can't actually find the probability ourselves, or when it's something that you can't physically find, like a math formula or probability for. I gave the example earlier of auto insurance. You, as a teenager, are more likely to get in a car crash than your parents are, just because you're newer at driving and everything. And auto insurance companies have actually calculated what the odds are that you'll get in a car crash, and that factors into why you have to pay more for your auto insurance than your parents probably do. So you can find a probability. There's no like secret hidden probability that like you can do a formula on for what's the probability you'll get in an accident. But what they do is they take lots of data. Well, how many teenagers are driving? How much do they drive for? Out of how many possible days or time, like time limit? And they calculate an estimated probability. It can also be used in problems like with my jar of marbles example. Let's say I have a jar of marbles with five blues and five reds, and I wanted to know what's the probability I get a red marble. If I couldn't see in the jar or couldn't figure out that there were 10 right there, what I could do is I could pick a marble, I could look at it and see if it's red or not, replace it, pick another marble, and if I kept doing that a bunch of times, I could look at the percent of the time I got a red marble and estimate the probability that way. Now, when you do something like this, you have to make sure you have enough data. If my jar has five reds and five blues, if I do it 10 times, putting the marble back each time, I could get like seven or eight reds just by chance. I could also get one or two reds. So I would be off on my probability if I didn't collect very much data, because you need lots of data to get a good picture of what's going on. If I did this 1,000 times where I picked out my marble, I'd be pretty surprised if I had like 700 or 800. I should get closer to midway, so like 500 each. So when you calculate data, you need to make sure if you're calculating a probability, you do enough data and you don't go with a really, really small sample. So for today, you have an assignment that you're just going to do somewhere around your house. What I need you to do is find the probability of something that is interesting, that you can do easily with the materials around you. It can be about anything you want, as long as it's safe and school appropriate. So you're just gonna pick something that you feel like finding the probability of, and you're gonna do it 100 times. So I have three different examples here just to give you guys ideas for like what you could do brainstorming wise, but come up with something creative. All you're gonna do is do it 100 times, and then you're gonna submit what you did and what you got for the probability. And that's it. That's your assignment for here. So my couple of topics that I have, if I pick two socks out of a drawer at random, what's the probability they match? So I can pick two, look at them if they match or not, and do that 100 times and keep track of what the probability is. I could be trying to shoot like a paper basketball across the room and see what my probability of making it in the garbage can is. Or I could be calling to my cat from across the room and seeing like what's the probability my cat will actually come to me over time. I'm sure you can think of something creative. It's a chance to find a probability for something you wouldn't otherwise have the time or wants to do. So use it as an opportunity to do something kind of interesting, and then you'll send me those results when you get them.